Hello, welcome back. In this segment, I will show how RSA unpadding is actually performed in mature libraries like OpenJDK. In the previous segment, I had a quick and dirty Python implementation to show the idea of padding and unpadding, but it's not really production quality. It's actually vulnerable to timing attacks, but I want to show in real life how unpadding is actually done. Okay, remember, this is the PKCS format that we have been discussing. Before encrypting a message M, we need to add randomness. The randomness is added here, right? This is the randomness R. So same message encrypted will have a different ciphertext. That's the idea. This is 0, this is 0, 2, randomness, and then 0, and then AM. This R should not have any zeros. That's the idea of this padding mode. 0, 2 stands for encryption, right? And 0, 1 stands for digital signature, which we will talk later. Okay. So let me now show to you with that brief background how a mature library actually handles the unpadding aspect. So what you're seeing is OpenJDK version 11. I will show you the key components of this code, which is called unpad v15. This is, well, it's 1.5. Can't put point on the method name. That's the reason it's looking like v15. It's PKCS 1.5. Okay. What is padded? Assume padded means that 00 followed by 02, the string that I shown as a sequence of bytes. And the very first thing we need to check is that at k equal to 0, right, padded of 0 is 0, right? If it is not, that means there is something wrong. So we say bad padding is true, okay? And then we go ahead and check whether the second type, remember the type 2 means encryption. So the second byte in this padded sequence is number 2. If it is not, we again say padding error is true. Once we go through that first step, we go into a loop and look for the zero. Remember, there must be a zero before the message starts. So where are we finding the zero? We go byte by byte in the padded input array, right? And check whether we reached a zero. If we reach a zero, we check whether it's the first zero. Remember the first zero, okay? If it is the first zero, we make a note of it, okay? In that case, it means, so we found out this zero, okay? The message M can also have 0 bytes, of course, but we are only interested in finding the place where the zero is from the left, okay, after the R, okay? But where is R and where is M? Let me show you that now. So we find the place where the zero is. Okay, in the worst case, the zero may not be there. Maybe something wrong with the padding. So if we reach the K to be padded length, that means we exhausted all the bytes and we have not found padded byte. That's the reason our P is remaining still zero. Otherwise, we would have updated it by some other number, some other non-zero number. In that case, we know we reached a padding error. That's the reason why they put padding is true. Okay, this is for digital signature part. We can skip it because I'm talking about encryption only at this point. And then they continue the loop, right? They don't break the loop so that the attacker will not know exactly where the error happened. So they continue the loop for all the bytes of the padded bytes, right? And then they come out of the loop, meaning they finished all the bytes. So they take the padded length and subtract it by P. What is P? P is either the position where the zero occurred, right? Or P is zero. In the worst case, when there is no zero properly put, P will be zero. Okay, otherwise P will be K. So what is the reason they're doing the padded length minus P? Now let me go back to the whiteboard. The padded length means all the bytes here, right? The whole thing. Number of bytes. And where is the P pointing to? P is actually pointing to this particular byte, the first byte after 00. Because remember, we do K++ in the code. That means we point to the place where the message starts. So we subtract the overall length. So overall length is this length minus the place where the message starts. That will give us the actual number of bytes that are present over here, right? M is made of multiple bytes. We will find out how many bytes are there. That is the message length. Okay. That's what that particular portion of the code is doing. And they check whether message length is greater than max data sites. Remember, again, in the previous segment, I talked about having at least 11 bytes for the randomness, right? This is 8, at least 8 bytes, 9, 10, and 11. Suppose R is too small, meaning M is very large, then we reject that. That's the reason why they put padding error is to be true. Bad padding is true, okay? That's basically it. And then they go ahead and perform some useless operation here. The reason for the useless operation is pretty interesting. They create an array of bytes, right? How many bytes? P bytes. P stands for the position where the message starts, right? So they create an artificial padding array, right? And copy the first P bytes, excluding the index P, of course, into this padding array. That's what they're doing. And here they're actually copying the data. The data is the N bytes, right? Data is made of N bytes. From the padded array, they take from the place where the array, the message starts, they take N bytes. Okay, N stands for the number of bytes. Okay, so in total, how many bytes did they copy? Here they copied P and here they copy N, totally P plus N. So from an attacker's point of view, they don't know the message length because we don't leak the length of the message. That's the reason they do this interesting trick. Okay. And then they check whether bad padding is true. If it is true, they throw an exception. Otherwise, they return the data. The interesting point to note is that code not necessarily leak the fact that the padding error happened here, meaning the first byte is not zero or not two, or is not sufficient length, or there's a zero afterwards. It doesn't leak any of those. It's done in a way that it's continuing the loop. So it doesn't break the while loop, so to speak. And it doesn't leak the length of the message M because they're creating another artificial array to copy all of these, right? And then they copy all of the message bytes into the return array. So this is pretty interesting. Cryptographic implementation is not easy to do. And this is one interesting example to show to you how in real world, even something like unpadding can be more complicated. Okay, that's all. Hopefully you find this interesting.